जय हिंद टू ऑल. माय नेम इज धनश्री परिहार, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट, अजय कुमार गर्ग इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज. टुडे माय टॉपिक इज इनपुट आउटपुट डिवाइसेस. माय टॉपिक इंक्लूड्स पेरिफेरल डिवाइसेस इंट्रोडक्शन, इनपुट आउटपुट इंटरफेस, ट्रांसमिशन ऑफ डेटा इन एसिंक्रोनस मोड, प्रायोरिटी इंटरप्ट्स, डायरेक्ट मेमोरी एक्सेस एंड इनपुट आउटपुट प्रोसेसर. So let's start with the introduction to peripheral devices. Now, what are peripheral devices? As we all know, peripheral devices are input-output devices. So we have three types of peripheral devices. One is the input peripheral device, another is the output peripheral device, and third one is both the input-output peripheral devices. So few example of these devices are: in input device, we have keyboard. The optical input device like card reader, paper tape reader, barcode reader, which we use in a used for shopping and all, where we read a barcode from a product and it will be readed, and the information regarding that particular item will be noted in our software. We have magnetic tapes, and then we have screen as a input device. Now, output devices, we have a card puncher, paper tape ka puncher, CRT cathode ray tube monitors, printers like daisy wheel printer, dot matrix printer, laser printer and plotter. We have third mode device, which is also known as the input output device, a device which will be acting as a input as well as a output device at the same time. An example of that device is your touch screen. Now in touch screen, we will be inserting an input by touching the interface of that screen. And when we get an output of that, after the touching, we get a certain output on our screen, that is the output interface of that, the same screen. So it will be acting as an input as well as output device. Now next is the input-output interface. Now what is interface? Actually, interface is a medium between the data transmitting the data between the processor and your input output devices. As we see in this diagram, we are having many input output devices connected with your processor, that is your CPU, through data bus, address bus and control bus. Here the interface play a important role in forming a platform between a processor and a keyboard and the printer, magnetic tape, disk for transmission of data. Now, how that transmission can be formed? Once your information is being noted to be accessed from your memory, what will happen? A processor will issue an address which will be placed on your address bus. And after placing that address, a data is also placed on the data bus. When that address and data is being available on the this address and data bus, then the interfaces, that address will be sent to your all the interfaces. Now, what will happen when the address will be sent to the interfaces? That address will be checked in correspondence to their connected input-output device, either the keyboard, printer, tape or magnetic disk. Now, if the address belongs to that particular interface, that address belongs to only one of the interface, not to all the interfaces. So, the address which is being uploaded on the address bus belong to any one of them, and only that interface will get open for which that address belongs to. That will be available on our address bus. And all other interfaces will reject the communication by closing this channel of communication. And only one at a time will open that channel for communication. And the data which will be uploaded on the data bus will be transferred to that particular device. So for example, in this case, we will consider that the address will be uploaded by a processor on address bus, and that belongs to a printer. Now, what will happen? And the data is also being available. We want to make, we have to conduct some printing operation and we want to have some printouts. So what will happen? An address will be uploaded on an address one. That address belongs to a printer. That will be address of a printer. What will happen? The data is also uploaded. That address will float on the address bus, and then that address will be received by all the interfaces. Interface 1, interface 2, interface 3 and interface 4. But only the interface number 2, this one, 1, 2, 3 and 4. The interface number 2 will open its channel, because the address on the address bus will belongs to this particular interface, and the connected printer will then get that data from the database and makes our printout and give us a printout, and all other interfaces will reject those transmission. Why? Because that address which is placed on the address bus doesn't belong to those interfaces. So this is the way how the interface will act as a kind of a connector between the processor and your input output devices. So interface, it will decode the device address, as we already seen in this example how it will be decoding that address, and it also decodes the command. Command may include your reading command and writing command, read and write control commands. Then it provides the signals for the peripheral controllers, okay, what kind of operation they are going to perform, either a reading operation or a writing operation. Then the synchronization of data flow also will be supervised by the interface. So synchronization means that communication between the processor and your input output devices, that will be accurately occurring or not. And then transmit rate between the peripheral and the CPU. As we all know that the CPU transmission speed is higher than that of your input output devices. So there is a speed gap between the peripheral devices and your CPU. So we are having four types of commands which will be conducted by the interface for smooth functioning of transmission of data between the CPU and the input output devices. These are the control command, which will be issued to activate the peripheral and to inform what to do next, peripheral devices. Okay. Next is status command. Now, what is this command? This is used to generally check the status of your input output devices that is being connected to your interface, whether that input output devices are busy in some other task or whether it is available. So to see that status, this status command is being issued, and the condition, the present condition and the present state of the input output device will be checked. Next is the data output command. In this command, it will cause the interface to respond by transferring the data bus, the data into the one of the data bus, and then transferring the data from the bus to the register. So we are transmitting the data from the CPU to the bus and then from data bus to the register. So that is your data output command. Now, in data input command, what will happen? Data input command, the data from these input output devices through an interface being uploaded on your data bus and then being uploaded in your register. So this is your data input command. So these are the four types of command that is being used by interface or issued by the interface to perform these certain operations. So this is the functioning of an interface. Now next we are having the types of buses, or we can say the organization of buses, the input bus and the memory bus, the functions of buses. Now memory bus is for information transfer between the CPU and the main memory when we want to exchange the data between the processor and the RAM memory. So we will have one set of buses over there, that is known as your memory bus. And then we have an input bus, which is used for transferring the information between the input output devices and your CPU. So that set of buses which is used for transferring the data is known as your input output bus. Majorly we have three buses: control bus, data bus and address bus. So we are organizing them accordingly, whether we are transferring the data between the memory and the CPU or between the input output devices and the CPU. So there are three ways to make that organization possible. Those three ways are: first, we can use a separate set of buses both for input output devices and for memory devices, that is for main memory, that is for RAM. So a separate set of buses is there for transmitting the data between the input output devices and the memory, and a separate set of buses, that is the address, data and control bus, for transferring the data between the main memory and your CPU. That is the first organization scheme. Now second scheme is using a common bus for memory and input output device. So which set of bus we are using commonly? That is data bus and address bus we are using commonly for both memory and for input output devices, and a separate control lines are used for both the devices. And the third scheme where we use three of the buses commonly, not any separating any one of them. So this is how we can show with this diagram. In a one set, what we will be doing, we are using common address bus and data bus for the memory unit as well as for the input output devices, that is for main memory unit RAM, and a separate control line. Now in this kind of scheme, what we are doing, we are making a differentiation between the memory and the input output devices on the basis of your control lines, their control signals, whether that reading and writing operation will be performed on the input output device or that reading writing control operation will be performed on the memory device. But the data which will be shared on the buses, that will be common to both. Now how the data being transferred, that will depend upon the address being issued. So the same kind of address will be issued on the address bus, and the address, if it belongs to memory, will be accepted by the memory, and the corresponding control operation will be performed by the memory, which is commonly shared on the address bus, on that particular data which will be shared on the data bus. But if that address which is being shared on the address bus belongs to input output device, any one of the input output devices, printer, monitor, keyboard and all, then the corresponding control operation will be performed, either a reading operation or a writing operation. So this is the first scheme where we are commonly using the address bus and data bus and separating our control line. Now next scheme is in which we will commonly using the three of the buses, the address, data and the control bus. In this kind of organization scheme, we'll be using the same space for storing the memory instruction as well as your input output instructions, and the same instruction can be used to make a action on the memory, means any reading writing operation on the memory, and the same set of instruction can be used for the input output devices, and the address and data is commonly available on the both of buses. Here we are, as we are using additional hardware, so this is a costly scheme we can say, and here we are commonly using the three things and the common set of instruction is used. So this scheme is cheaper than that of the first scheme, that is the input output mapped, and this is your memory mapped scheme. Now next is asynchronous data transmission. So data transmission can be done in two ways. One is the asynchronous mode of transmission and one is the synchronous mode of transmission. Now, before understanding the asynchronous mode of transmission, we first know what is the synchronous transmission. As we know that the CPU is a high-speed device, we can say. So, and the input-output devices are slow-speed devices. So, the transmission between the CPU and the register, that will be done on the same speed. So, that kind of transmission, we can say a synchronous transmission, where we can use a clock pulse to know whether the data that being sent will be in a particular clock cycle will be accessed or will be transferred or maybe delivered to the destination or not. So there in synchronous transmission, we will use a clock pulse for this purpose. But in asynchronous transmission, what will happen, as the input output devices are slow functioning devices, their speed is very slow as compared to your CPU. So on operating on a same speed is not possible. So at that time, the transmission between the input output devices and the CPU, the data transmission will be on a asynchronous mode. Now, what is the asynchronous data transmission and how it can be performed? So there are two ways for performing this asynchronous data transmission. One is the strobing method and another is the handshaking method. Now, what is strobing method? Now, in a strobing method, we have two another types of schemes. That is, one is the source-initiated asynchronous data transmission and one is destination-initiated asynchronous data transmission. In a source-initiated asynchronous data transmission, we have a source unit and a destination unit. The source unit may be your CPU, and this destination may be your interface, you can say, or any, you can say, input output devices which is connected to your interface, suppose printer. Now what will happen in source initiated input output transmission, we can say asynchronous transmission. First of all, a strobe signal will be activated to a high value, that is to one value, and a data from a source unit will be placed on the data bus, and this line will be also activated accordingly. First activities. So this strobing signal will be an indication to destination unit that the data on the Dataverse, which will be placed by the source unit, is a valid data, and that is now available, and the destination unit can now accept this data. And the strobing signal will indicate that validity of data on the Dataverse. Now, when this signal is being received by the destination unit, it will start collecting the data from the Dataverse. In certain duration of time, we can say it is start accepting that. So this is a source initiating synchronous data asynchronous data transmission. Next is destination initiated asynchronous data transmission in strobing. Now, in this kind of scheme here, the first step, that is the starting of communication, is being done by now the destination unit, not by the source unit. Now, what will happen? The destination unit will activate the strobe signal, makes its value to high, 1. And then this will being received by the source unit. When this signal is being received by the source unit, the data from the source unit will be sent on the data bus, a valid date. So first the strobe signal will be activated, like this it will be shown in this timing diagram. And then after that, after some duration, that valid data signal will be being getterized. The data is being uploaded on the data bus after receiving this strobe signal. And the destination unit start receiving this data from the data bus. Now, when the destination unit received the certain amount of data, it will, what will done? It will deactivate this strobing signal, make it 0. And then this will be received by the source unit, the signal 0. And then the data on the data bus will not be uploaded by the source unit. And the data on the data bus become now invalid, not being accepted by the destination unit. So this is the way how the source unit and a destination unit will communicate in a strobing kind of communication, asynchronous communication. Same with the case of source initiated. Once the data is being received by this, maybe after some duration of time, the source unit will deactivate this strobe signal, which will be an indication to the data bus, the data on the data bus is not valid after its value become this 0. So data is valid till your clock cycle is 1, means that data validity is a high rise of this clock cycle, we can say, of this timing diagram, till your strobing is being activated. After strobe signals get deactivated, it will become to 0, its value will become 0, then the data on the data bus is no more valid. But there is a disadvantage of this scheme. In this scheme of asynchronous data transmission, what will happen? As there is no way of knowing by the destination unit in a source initiated that the data is, that data that will be put on the data bus is a valid data or being received by a that data being received by the destination unit is completed or not. So there is no way of knowing by the source unit that the data is being received by the destination unit, because in source initiated unit there is no acknowledgement of receiving of data by the destination unit. Similarly, in a destination initiated strobing asynchronous transmission, there is no way of knowing by the source unit whether the data is again being received by this destination unit, because the strobe signal is down, but that validity of data is not appropriate and not been we can say authenticated by your source unit on any terms, because there is no acknowledgement of that transmission again. So for removing that problem, the another scheme that is known as the handshaking scheme, in which the third signal that is called as a handshaking, we can say, signal is also added to your source and destination unit. One more line is connected over there. So in a, again, we are having two types of asynchronous handshaking data transmission. One is the source initiated and another is the destination initiated. Source initiated, where the communication is being started by the source unit, and destination initiated means where the communication is first being started by or initiated by your destination unit. So here we are having that source unit again and the destination unit again, and we have three connection lines between them. The data bus line, the data valid line, similar to the strobing signal, and another third line, which is known as your data acceptance line, which we can say as an acknowledgement signal to your source unit. Now, what will happen? First of all, the data is being placed on the bus by your source unit, and the data valid signal is also become 1. So, these lines will become 1. The data is being given by the source unit to the data bus, and the data will valid signal is also become high. Means the valid data is flowing in your data bus. Now, when it approaches to your destination unit, the destination unit start accepting this data from your data bus. And when the data after a certain amount of time is being completely received by the destination unit, it will activate this data acceptance signal to 1, which is a kind of acknowledgement to the source unit that the data which is being sent by the source unit on the data bus is completely received by your destination unit. Now, after receiving this data acceptance signal by the source unit will deactivate your data valid signals and also not put any data on the data bus, which is an indication to destination unit that that acknowledgement is being received by your source unit. Similarly, the destination unit also deactivates signal to 0, that now next no data will be received. Again, to restart the communication, the data valid line will be reactivated and the new data will be put on the data bus. So this is a source initiated asynchronous data transmission. Similarly, we have a destination initiated asynchronous data transmission in a handshaking protocol. In this kind of transmission, what will happen? The communication is being first started by your destination unit. So what will happen? First of all, the destination unit, this unit will activate this ready for data signal to 1, means make it high, and this signal is being received by your source unit. So this is a kind of a, we can say, a request to your source unit that I am now available and I am free, now start the communication with me. So after receiving the signal, the source unit will activate the data valid lines as well as put the data on the data bus. So their value will become 1. These lines are also activated and data is being put on the data bus. Now this data which is put on the data bus is now started being collected by your destination unit. And to what extent it will be collecting the data? Till it will be deactivating the ready for data signals. Now when it will be collect the data in an appropriate duration of time, after that it will deactivate this ready for data signal, which is a kind of an indication to source unit. Now the data that which being sent by the source unit is completely received by the destination unit. And in response to that, it will deactivate this data bus as well as the data valid signals to 0 value, which will an indication to destination unit that the data that being previously being transferred is now stopped. And after that, the destination unit will issue a new ready for data state, means after a certain duration of time. So this is a kind of asynchronous data transmission. Now how it will be possible in a kind of we can a clock cycle. During the asynchronous data transmission, first the start will always be 0, that will be indicating the start of your asynchronous transmission. Then we have a certain bits, the combination of 0 and 1 will be showing the data transmission in a asynchronous mode, and the stopping bit will be 1, and then after that again 1, 1, 1, 1. When a sequence of 1 is received in a signal, it means that the complete set, we can say a packet, or we can say a set of information is being transferred. So starting is initiated by a 0 value and the ending of the data transmission is indicated by the continuous 1 value. And the it be in between, the value of characters will be in a form of 0 is 1, the combination of 0 and 1. So when we are start getting that continuous 1, it means that the data is being received and now the transmission is being stopped by the unit. So this is the your asynchronous transmission, strobing and handshake. Now next is the modes of transfer in your computer system. As I have discussed earlier that the input output devices and the peripheral devices, that peripheral devices and the CPU, central processing unit, they will operate on different speed, as the speed of CPU is very faster than that of, we can say, input output devices. So there are 3 modes of transmission between them, the 3 ways how we can communicate that transmission between the thing, organization schemes. One is your programmed input output scheme, another is interrupt initiated input output scheme, and third is DMA, direct memory access scheme. So let us discuss the direct memory access scheme, how it is possible without using your CPU to transmit the information between the memory unit and the input output devices. So this is your DMA, direct memory access device. In a DMA, we have a controller chip which is known as a DMA controller chip, which will include certain signals like DMA select, the read select, reading lines, writing line, bus request lines, bus grant lines, and interrupt lines. Now, what is a DMA? DMA is a controller chip which will be work as we can say on a behalf of a CPU for transmitting the data between the main memory and we can say input output devices without intervention of CPU, we can say, as CPU is a very, we can say, fast device and a very busy device. So every time it is not possible to involve a CPU for communicating the data or transferring the data between the memory and the input output devices. So in order to increase the efficiency of, we can say, CPU, we will use a DMA controller chip which in a place of a CPU can control this transmission. Now, how this transmission can be possible? This is a block diagram of DMA transmission. Here we are having the CPU, which will be having the control of all the three buses, we can say address bus, data bus, and your control bus, including your reading and writing control. This is your DMA control chip and input output devices. Now, what will happen in this transmission? The input output devices first generate a request to DMA that we need to transmit the data between the RAM and between the devices, that we want to communicate, start a communication with the RAM, random access memory, that is the main memory. Now, initially the CPU is having the control of all the buses, the data bus, address bus, and the reading writing bus. So DMA is not having that control, as the CPU is the master of your computer system. Now, when this acknowledgement is being received by the DMA controller chip, what will happen? It will generate an interrupt to the CPU, which will indicate CPU that something is going to happen, and now I have to stop whatever I am doing. That CPU currently doing the task, that will be stopped by the CPU, and it have to look for the DMA interrupt. Now, after interrupting its current process, it will generate a bus request signal, which will be given to, that will become a one to CPU. So it is a kind of a request to CPU that kindly issue the control of these three buses, address bus, data bus, and control bus to me, so that I can form a communication between the RAM and the input output devices on your behalf, on the behalf of your CPU. So what will happen? The CPU will look for this bus request signal, and in response to this bus request signal, it will generate a bus grant signal and become its value and make its value to 1. When the value of bus grant signal become 1, it means the DMA controller will get the controller for these three buses, the data bus, the address bus, and the control bus, the reading writing operation. And when it will be getting the control of these buses, it will be start, it will allow the input output devices to transmit the data directly between the RAM and the input output devices through this channel, through this data line. And the address at which the data is being transferred, the location of that memory from where the data is being accessed or read from or write into, will be issued by your DMA controller through your address lines. And reading writing lines will ensure the operation, kind of operation, either a reading operation or a writing operation. Where the DS select chip is for selecting the DMA controller chip on behalf of your CPU. Now, in this way, the communication is being set between the RAM and the peripheral devices. In that, at that moment, the CPU is not involved in that communication. When input output devices is accessing your RAM, or RAM is accessing your this input output devices, the DMA controller is being involved in that process. So there are two things we can have a look on while transmitting the data. One is the burst transfer in a data transmission, and one is a cycle stealing phenomena, very important terms during your DMA transmission. So first is a burst transfer. In a burst transfer, a sequence of, we can say, a block consisting of memory bursts is being transferred in a continuous burst. First, we can say a very large amount of data, we can say, is being transferred while the DMA controller is the master of your buses, memory buses, that is address bus, data bus, and the control bus. So very big number of blocks, we can say, or we can say packets is being transferred from your input output devices to your main memory, or from main memory to your input output device. So that is a kind of a burst transfer. That is a advantage being taken by a DMA controller to transfer maximum amount of data when it will be the master of the buses. Now next is the cycle stealing phenomena. In a cycle stealing phenomena, DMA is currently not the master of the buses, but your CPU is. Now what will happen? The CPU, when in busy in transmitting the data, the DMA will in between interrupt the CPU and steal it one clock cycle, we can say, or one cycle. In that one cycle, it will get the master of control of the buses and become the master and start transmitting the data between the RAM and the input output devices. That is a cycle stealing phenomena in which the CPU is being interrupted for its continuous data transmission by the DMA controller, and it will steal one or two of its clock cycle, and at that duration, when while it will steal, it will get the control of buses. It will we can say transfer a minimum, or we can say small amount of data to from RAM and the input output devices. This is your cycle stealing phenomena. We can say how DMA is sending the information to the data bus in the form of what thing? It will start the address bus in the issue a read or write signal, or a word count register is also there to count how much amount of data is being transferred. The control to specify whether a reading or writing control is there, or to control or start the DMA transfers. So there will be also a control signal for initiating that particular transmission. Now next we can say this is a DMA transmission, direct memory access transmission. And the another is a other kind of transmission which we can use is your priority based transmission, or we can say interrupt based transmission. In interrupt based transmission, the interrupt is being initiated by your hardware or by your software to the CPU to currently halt all the processes which is currently doing and to execute the interrupt. Interrupt means a kind of a, we can say, high priority task which the CPU have to do at that particular moment, even though it is doing some process at that particular moment. So that is your interrupts, that is interrupt initiated input output control. So in interrupt initiated, we have a priority interrupts. In a priority interrupts, what will happen? We have an example of priority interrupt is our daisy chaining. In a daisy chaining technique, which is a kind of a vector interrupt, we can say, in a daisy chaining interrupt, when the CPU is currently doing some task and it is busy in some current task, an interrupt will be given by a hardware, and that interrupt is being initiated by the CPU. Now, how this interrupt is being acknowledged or being initiated by the CPU? Now, first of all, suppose we have a devices which are connected in a sequence, daisy chaining, we can say priority interrupt. So device one is there, device two is there, and device, they are connected in a sequence. So we have a PI, that is priority input and priority output connection or line, we can say over here. What will happen when any one of the device will generate an interrupt? Suppose device number two will wants the CPU to do its task first. So it will activate this interrupt request lines, and it will give a interrupt to your CPU. Now CPU in reverse to that will halt its current task, whatever it will be doing, and as an acknowledgement, it will be acting this interrupt acknowledgement signal, and this will be being received by the device one. So as we know that in this example, device two will be generating the interrupt, not the device one. But in daisy chaining, as the devices are connected in a sequence, even though the device 2 is generating the interrupt, the first acknowledgement is being received by the device number 1 and through your priority input lines. The value of that priority input lines will become 1 at that moment when it is being received. Now device 1 will be checked that whether that that interrupt is not given by me, as that address which is being issued by that device number 2, that vector address, that doesn't belong to this particular device. Now, when the interrupt is being requested by the device, a vector, its corresponding vector address is also given to the CPU, indicating that the location of device which is generating the interrupt is device number 2. This one is the that device. So that address will be checked. Device number one is not that device which will be initiating the interrupt, and that will be passed on to the device number two through making this PO value to be one. One means transferring the data to the opening the channel and transferring the data to next device. Now, when a device two will be receiving that priority interrupt signal, that will be blocked by this device. Why? Because that interrupt is being given by the device number two, and the PO signal will become zero. It means that that signal will further not be transferred to device number three, and its corresponding vector address is also judged by the CPU that this is the device which will be issuing that interrupt, and then that particular device will be served against that interrupt. So device number two will be then served for that interrupt. This kind of interrupt is known as your priority interrupt, or we can say a kind of priority interrupt in which the high priority device is placed for in a first position, then the second position is second priority interrupt, then the third device, the third in the priority. But even though the priority of device number one is high then as compared to two, the request will be being transferred by the device number one to device number two, and its corresponding vector address is also being issued. So this is a kind of a, we can say, hardware interrupt based on the priority. One another type of interrupt is also there, which is known as the parallel priority interrupts. In the parallel priority interrupts, what will be happen? A masking register will be containing some masking bit, and a devices are being connected in a parallel order in a register, we can say, and the ending of that formation will be formed like ending 00 will give a I0 value that will belong to disk device, and then ending of 1 and 1 will give 1, that is I1 value, I0 value, I2 and I3, that will be on the basis of those priorities, this device and your the masking bit. So these device are masked with this masking bit in corresponding to the interrupt register, and their ending operation will perform I0, I1, I2 and I3 in respect to that, and that signal will generate the value of X and Y signal, and while X value will be 0, 0, 01 like this, 1, 1, 1, 0 and all, both the values X and Y values, and then according to them that vector address will be generated and the CPU will initiate that particular interrupt connected from that parallel priority interrupt devices. Thank you.